Commemoration of a departed soul who had left for his heavenly abode after completion of a relentless journey in the planet, achieving a myriad success for himself and for his fraternity as well, is certainly a glorious tradition of our rich heritage and culture and a unique disposition in reminiscence of its inspiring contributions. The man leaves this mundane world but leaves behind his indelible footprints for the posterities to follow. Legacy of the legend like Barrister Ranjit Mahanty is certainly a proud phenomenon for we, the Odias, to imbibe and inculcate. Late Barrister Ranjit Mahanty would hardly require an introduction. Besides a legal luminary, he had immense contributions in varied facets of life. The doyen of the bar as he was, simultaneously was a great thinker, social engineer, harbinger of reforms in legal education and legal profession, sentinel of democracy and democratic ethos, and above all, an enchanting human being endeared by one and all.
After having completed his education in the last time university, having his career as a lawyer in last time High Court, having an extensive practice in last time, and he also appeared in many matters in Gujarat High Court, and also other places of the country. Justice Rafique was elevated as judge of the last time High Court in 2006 and served twice as the acting Chief Justice. Joined the Orissa High Court on 27th of April 2020 with an amiable personality, as well as sharp understanding of the issues involved in the case. Justice Rafique has already been admired and respected by the bar within this short period. Justice Rafique has shown exemplary leadership, as well as displayed his past experience in handling the functioning of the High Court and subordinate courts throughout the Orissa. Situation of the pandemic, Justice Rafique's approach has inspired the lawyer and the litigants alike, which has resulted in reposing the much required confidence in the judicial system, which is that we should try to do this for the future. Sri Hon'ble Mr, the senior advocate, who after very short notice has accepted our invitation to be the president of this function, asked Sri Aniruddha Bose was unable to attend. Sir Honble Mr, senior advocate, is an eminent lawyer who was born in a glorious family. Sir Mr joined the bar in 1978 under Sir B.P. Rath, who is a very senior advocate, and Sir Mr was designated as a senior advocate in 2011. Sir Mr has appeared in numerous cases in all sorts of law in Odisha and outside the state of Odisha. He has been a member of the State Bar Council, and he is also the former Rotarian. He is president of the Rotary Club. He is associated with the Eye Hospital in the Cuttack, which is one of the best hospitals in the country. I welcome him and thank him for sparing me time. I am very sorry that I have received the message from Shraddha, chairman of the eminent committee, that he is in home quarantine for cough, for which he could not attend the commemorative day. I wish that he should have a speedy recovery so that he can come and meet this bond. With this, I end.
But the reversal of the question. Now, I request our Chief Justice, Honorable Sri Justice Mahanty, and Chief Justice of Odisha High Court to speak a few words.
Mahanty and his late mother, Srimati Shakuntala Mahanty. His father was himself a dedicated lawyer of his time, and his mother, besides being a social activist, was also a lawyer. Late Barrister Ranjit Mahanty did his bar at law from the prestigious Lincoln School in London. Initially, he joined as a young lecturer of law at the Barcelona University of Spain, but soon left that job to join the legal profession at Rafique in the year 1955. Within a short span of time, that Barrister Ranjit Mahanty made a mark for himself as an eminent lawyer, whose name and fame spread beyond the boundaries of the state. Late Barrister Ranjit Mahanty was the president of the Orissa High Court Bar Association for many terms. He was also the president of all Orissa Lawyers Association. He was elected as member of the Bar Council of Orissa on many occasions. In 1979, he was elected as the vice chairman of the Bar Council of India, and thereafter, in 1981, he was elected as chairman of the Bar Council of India, and then he was re-elected as chairman in the next term. Late Barrister Sri Ranjit Mahanty's contribution to the legal profession as well as legal education throughout the country is widely acknowledged and fondly remembered. He was a visionary educationist. He was placed behind the 5-year integrated law program. He was also one of the founders of National Law School of India University, Bangalore. Late Barrister Sri Ranjit Mahanty was a custodian of human rights and social justice. He was involved in many philanthropic activities, not only in the state of Odisha but also in the entire country. He was actively associated with many social and cultural organizations. He was also a sports person, having keen interest in many sports. He was also in 1955 by doing his bar at law at London, a badminton champion. Later he was the president of Odisha Hockey Association and Odisha Badminton Association. Late Barrister Sri Ranjit Mahanty was a story of success. He has been a source of inspiration for many young lawyers in the state of Odisha. He was always ready and willing to extend his helping hand to all those who needed it. He was very affectionate towards the junior members of the bar and was always eager to help them in whatever way they could. Barrister Ranjit Mahanty Memorial Committee was formed after his demise in the year 1989, which has organized today's program. This committee is helping the upcoming young bright lawyers to set up their personal library. I am told it has during the past 25 years donated law books and sets of monetary quarter to more than 600 lawyers in the state and 30 bar successes throughout the state. The footprints of late Barrister Sri Ranjit Mahanty on the sands of time will always remember source of inspiration for all of us. His success story is a case study for younger members of the bar to learn from, who want to follow his ideas and teachings for a better tomorrow. His legacy is being carried forward by his newborn son, Honble Mr. Justice Aniruddha Bose, the Chief Justice of Odisha High Court. I wish every success to Barrister Ranjit Memorial Committee in their endeavor to serve the legal fraternity of the state as per the agenda charted by late Barrister Sri Ranjit Mahanty, to keep his memory alive for the decisions to come. Thank you all. Jai Hind.
Vijay Krishna Mahanty, Senior Advocate and Chairman of the Entrants Committee, Orissa High Court Bar Association and Chairman of, and other members of the legal community, senior advocates and advocates who are before the video screen today at this hour. It is indeed both an honor and pleasure on being asked to deliver the keynote address today, the commemorative day of Barrister Ranjit Mahanty, the lawyer par excellence and also a man of immense courage and human values. I personally had interaction with him on a few occasions, as he was known to my father, who was also a lawyer. Later on, I met his able son, Honorable Chief Justice of Odisha High Court.
The Supreme Court of Bombay Presidency
had its inaugural session on 10th May 1824. In 1828 itself, within 4 years, a dispute arose when the court issued a writ of habeas corpus for production of one Muru Raghunath. At that time, he was in custody of his granddaughter. His father-in-law complained to the court that the guardian bore an evil influence on him. At that time, there was dual state of justice delivery system within the presidencies by the courts set up under the charter of the king, while in the Mahasal areas it was forum set up by the East India Company. In this particular case, the company administration declined to comply with the writ of Supreme Court of Bombay. Governor Malcolm wrote to the court asking not to execute the writ. Sir John Peter Grant, who was in the bench, then petitioned the sovereign. He wrote, it was within him, but quote, it was not hard that any ministers of the crown presumed to dictate to the kings of judges of the proceedings which should be allowed or disallowed. It was only a matter pending before them. Grant showed the majesty of law in 1828. Later, the Privy Council rejected the view of the judges of Bombay Supreme Court. Madras, as the city was then known, a similar situation arose subsequently to the Vellore Mutiny in the year 1806. A police force was set up after that when the force came to the city of Madras to quell the grain riot. Justice Henry William had the policemen arrested, holding that the force was illegal, since that was undertaken without sanction of the Supreme Court. Earlier, when the Supreme Court of Bengal was constituted, presided over by Sir Elijah Impey, the first Chief Justice had committed certain judicial officer appointed by the provincial government to custody and directed them to pay damages of rupees 3 lakhs on the ground that they had illegally exercised judicial power. In the latter case, which is commonly known as Asindura case, the Supreme Court had issued a writ against the zamindar of that place over collection of revenue, which the court found to be illegal. The court sought to execute the writ through the sheriff and his staff. Warren Hastings, the Governor General at that point of time, on the advice of the Advocate General Sir John Day, ordered his force to prevent execution of the judicial process by sheriffs. These were early assertions of instances of independence of the judicial system in India, though the country was under company, not even the rule of the empire. Satyanarayana Hegde is otherwise a revived man for many reasons, including mistrial of Bankuma. But he was also one of the first judges to accept the joint of the judiciary. M.C. Satyanarayana, first Attorney General for India, in an article wrote about him. Sarilaita Hegde, the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Judicature at 14 years, made history when with unbending independence he stood firm against the action of the Governor General and the military acting under his orders, thwarted the process of his court. Whatever the merits or demerits of Satyanarayana Hegde's part in encounter between judiciary and executive and the executive, there can be no doubt that it helped to establish the tradition of independence of judiciary. He acted with uncompromising boldness. I have started with the Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence, blending with our own system as it prevailed at that period of time. I would say it would be incorrect to suggest that the Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence had a parachute landing on this front. Mentioned Hindu law and later on, the period between the Buddhist period, and the Mughal period as well, a working judicial system was there in which highly developed laws based on rights, duties, and obligations were being applied. It is mentioned in the Narada Smriti that the king was to follow Dharma Shastra and take the cognizance of the assessment of the Chief Justice and maintain equanimity. Old texts like Katayana Smriti also highlights the importance of judicial independence. It quotes, when the king directs the judge to give an unjust decision in a case, the judge should beseech the king against the order which will lead to injustice and dissuade him from wrongdoing. Mughal period also had an organized judicial system with courts divided at central and provincial levels. There was a separate department of justice called Mahakamai Adalat. The emperor appointed the Chief Justice, Qazi Raza, who had original and accurate jurisdiction on civil and criminal cases. There was a separate department of justice. But what the introduction of the Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence was to introduce a precedent-based system which was also compatible with growing commercial needs of a post-industrial revolution society. I refer to a couple of instances of apparent friction between different views of the government and in the peculiar societal circumstances between the company having sense of its powers and the right-based judicial systems. I, however, not like to refer to these instances as frictions. These are really, as I have already observed, instances of reconciliation between two or multiple competing claims arising from introduction of a new economic order. The power of judiciary is really power to protect the right of individuals, and in many instances when these individuals are the weaker side in an ongoing dispute. That is the purpose we serve in the democratic setup. I must also acknowledge here that in this limited time and space on which I shall be dwelling on, I would not venture into a detail to develop a theory of justice in India in the 18th and 19th centuries. There are immense literature by very good scholars on that subject. I am only looking at it from the perspective of the legal community, not even a judge. By legal community, I mean the lawyers and judges, and also legal scholars together. The reason I am speaking on this subject today is that many of the court proceedings are being projected in a sensational manner in the general media, giving the idea of some kind of brinkmanship. The same issues are, however, not of recent origin. Has been in existence for at least two centuries and a half in this country. And through this process of reconciliation, the Indian society has enriched itself. The members of the respective audience will notice also that the cases I am referring to mainly originate from the courts of Bombay, Calcutta and Madras, and the city of Calcutta has several references. This is so because of the development of the judicial process was taking place at that point of time in India. In the Supreme Courts and later the High Courts, so in these three cities and the eponymous presidencies was taking place at that point of time in India. One figure stands out in the middle of the 19th century. Is Sir Barrister Ranjit. He was the last Chief Justice of Supreme Court of Bengal and first Chief Justice of the High Court of Calcutta. He can be referred to as founder of what can be termed as Indian common law. In the case of very insular and oriental steam navigation company. This judgment, interestingly, was not reported in any of the law journals of Calcutta, but found in its way into a note of the Bombay High Court.
Was legislated, there was
Yogendra Chand Bose. He was arriving in this section, 124 Capital A, in the Indian Penal Code, for taking a very radical stand against the state law.
Questions are asked about the difference of everything.
Judicial independence and its value to a democratic society would be befitting. I end here now. Thank you very much for inviting me to speak on the occasion. It's difficult times and there's some disruption here and there, but we have to overcome it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Honorable.
Thank you, Honorable Justice Bose, for delivering this brilliant keynote address. We have enriched our knowledge on the nurse's brilliant speech. Now, it is my turn to speak a few words as a president. It is always late, but I have to only few lines. Esteemed keynote speaker, Honorable Justice Aniruddha Bose, Judge Supreme Court of India. Esteemed Chief Justice of this Council, Honorable Mr. Justice Mahanty, Chief Justice of Orissa High Court. Honorable Justice Rafique, Honorable Mr. Justice Shraddha, Honorable Justice Mahanty, Chief Justice of Orissa High Court, and his family members, his brother, Mr. Justice Mahanty, and his family members, and the member of Barrister Ranjit Memorial Committee, my dear friends,
Sorry about this. I feel great privilege and honor to have been here today. Even though it is the only function going live or live, if I ensure that this function is being watched by thousands of viewers who I don't doubt personally, and the reason is to be leader of the bar, Barrister Ranjit Mahanty, Barrister Ranjit Mahanty. But lot of advocates love him, respectively. That's the reason why I said that thousands of viewers are seeing this function. I was junior member of the bar when Barrister Ranjit Mahanty was Indian University chosen president of the Barrister High Court Bar Association, and at the same time, was the chairman of the Apex statutory body of this legal profession, Bar Council of India, for contributing in 2 terms, that is about 4 years. And I was deeply moved by the governing leadership and the passion he was carrying up for the profession. I was very impressed by his arguments in court because he was so intelligent. He used to argue many days, but within that less argument, he was able to convince the other judges. So he was undisputed and undeclared doctor of newly entered to the legal profession, to whom Mr. Barrister Mahanty was the free philosopher and guide. He was truly a legend of his time, and his legal system continues. And in addition to all these qualities, he was a very kind-hearted man, magnanimous, and always helping others, especially the law and community. Today we are all missing such a great man and true leader and loving personality. Thank you. Now, I would like to offer a vote of thanks to Mr. Orissa High Court, who could not come and secretary could not come. We have had our irritant case note speaker today, Honorable Justice Aniruddha Bose, along with Mr. Ranjit Mahanty, senior advocate, who have apprised us about so many fond reminiscences of the death of the bar. I am on behalf of Memorial Committee, members of my Bar Association, and respected family members of the Barrister Mahanty, proudly complimentary our deep gratitude to Honorable Justice Aniruddha Bose, Judge Supreme Court of India, and for his lordship's keynote address and excellent speech.
I don't know.